The next item of business is a debate on motion 3394 in the name of Tom Arthur on Local Government Finance Scotland Order 2022. And I would invite those members who wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons now. And I call on Tom Arthur, Minister, to speak to and to move the motion. Around 7 minutes, please.
Presiding Officer, the purpose of today's debate on the Local Government Finance Order is to seek Parliament's approval to the guaranteed allocations of revenue funding to individual local authorities for 2022-23. It also seeks agreement to the allocation of additional funding for 2021-22, which has been identified since the 2021 order was approved on 18 March last year. Firstly, to put the local government settlement in the context of the overall Scottish budget, it should be noted that the Independent Scottish Fiscal Commission concluded that the overall Scottish budget in 2022-23 is 2.6% lower than in 2021-22. After accounting for inflation, the reduction is 5.2%. Despite this reduction, the 2022-23 local government finance settlement provides an additional 9.2% or a real terms increase of 6.3% compared to 2021-22. For the avoidance of doubt, this increase does not include the £280 million which the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and Economy announced during Stage 3 of the Budget Bill debate on 10 February and will enable local authorities to make cost of living awards of £150 to their most vulnerable council taxpayers. Do I have time, Presiding Officer?
If it's a brief intervention, please, Mr. Cole-Hamilton. Yes,
Mr. Brief intervention.
I'm very grateful to the Minister for giving way. He's doing a grand job of spinning this settlement, but I wonder if he's spoken to his fellow ministers, Lorna Slater or Ben McPherson, who were utterly eviscerated on Friday's COSLA conference for the reality of what this means for local cuts.
Minister.
Well, I would have to respond to the member by repeating the remarks that I just made, which is to set the context, which is that we are facing a 5.2% reduction in our overall budget, and the reality is, and I'm sure you'll correct me if I'm wrong later in the debate, but I do not recall Mr. Cole-Hamilton identifying budget lines for reduction to be reallocated to local government. So perhaps if he wants to reflect upon that, come our budget process for next year, for next financial year, later in the year, he can make a constructive contribution. Now, Presiding Officer, this settlement builds on the 2021-22 local government finance settlement that provided an increase in local government day-to-day spending of £375.6 million compared with the previous year. In 2022-23, including the additional £120 million of general uplift announced at Stage 1 of the Budget Bill, the Scottish Government will provide councils with a total funding package worth almost £12.7 billion. This includes revenue funding of £12 billion and support for capital expenditure of almost £0.7 billion. It is important to note that the total of this funding package is already finalised following the passing of the Scottish Budget Bill. Today's debate seeks Parliament's approval for the distribution of this approved total funding to individual local authorities. The order seeks approval for the distribution and payment of £11.4 billion out of the revenue total of £12 billion, with the balance mainly made up of specific grant funding which is administered separately. This £11.4 billion is a combination of general revenue grant of almost £8.4 billion and the distributable amount of non-domestic rates income which has been set at almost £2.8 billion. In addition to the 2022 order, the 2022 order rather includes £250 million of the cost of living further mentioned earlier, with a further £30 million to be included for approval in the 2023 order, subject to final reconciliation of the actual payments made by local authorities. Presiding Officer, the settlement not only provides local authorities with an additional £1 billion for vital day-to-day services and the flexibility to increase the council tax rate that are appropriate for their local authority area, but also provides continued fiscal certainty that doesn't exist in England through our policy of guaranteeing the combined general revenue grant plus non-domestic rates funding set out in this order. This means that any loss of non-domestic rate income resulting from the impact of Brexit or COVID-19 will be compensated for by increased general revenue grant, unlike the position for councils in England, effectively underwriting this critically important revenue stream. As approved as part of the Scottish Budget, the overall funding package for 2022-23 includes real terms growth to the overall settlement, an increase of £120 million in the core budget in cash terms, £353.9 million previously announced for health and social care integration, an additional £200 million to support investment in health and social care, £145 million for additional teachers and support staff, £68.2 million for child bridging payments, maintained funding for 100 day commitments, including scrapping curriculum and music tuition charges, and expanding school clothing grant, and an extra £64 million revenue and £30 million of capital funding to support the expansion of free school meals. Whilst not explicitly within the settlement itself, agreeing to this order also ensures that the funding to protect against increases in the cost of living finds its way into the pockets of households of the length and breadth of Scotland. Presiding officer, there remains a further £124 million of revenue funding that will be distributed once the necessary information becomes available and will be included for approval in the 2023 order. In addition to the revenue funding contained within today's order, there is specific revenue funding that is paid directly by the relevant policy areas under separate legislation, amounting to almost £785 million. The 2022 order also seeks approval for £840.7 million of changes to funding allocations for 2021-22. The full list of changes can be found in the report to the 2022 order. The funding includes almost £256 million to address COVID-19 pressures. Taken together with the additional £259 million included in the funding approved by Parliament on 18 March last year and the £1.2 billion approved in the previous financial year, this brings the value of the overall COVID-19 support package for councils up to over £1.7 billion, over and above their regular grant payments. The Scottish Government has also replaced almost £1.7 billion worth of non-domestic rate incomes for the cost of COVID reliefs with additional general revenue grants since the start of COVID. In summary, Presiding Officer, the Budget Bill ensured that total funding from the Scottish Government to local government next year amounts to almost £12.7 billion. This represents an increase of over £1 billion or 9.2% in cash terms. That's a real terms increase of 6.3% compared with 2021-22. The order confirms the distribution to individual councils, and the proposals reflect the key role that local government will play as we focus on how we can lift children out of poverty, invest in social care and tackle climate change. The Scottish Government will continue to work in partnership with local government to improve outcomes and ensure communities receive the lifeline support and services that they expect and deserve. In closing, Presiding Officer, I now move that Parliament approves Local Government Finance Scotland Order for 2022.
Thank you, Minister. And I call on Miles Briggs to speak on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. Up to 6 minutes. Please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. This is an important debate, and not just a technical one. And I want to open my contribution today by thanking all those who work in our local authorities across Scotland for their hard work, especially going the extra mile during the pandemic. The Local Government Finance Order 2022 comes at the tail end of the budget process, and given that we've spent weeks now debating the SNP Green Scottish Government tax and spending choices, it might seem at this point that there's little more to add. Nevertheless, it is important that the parliamentary process of today does highlight and give opportunity for all of us to highlight what needs to change. The order before us allocates funding to each of Scotland's 32 local authorities. Now, we do not intend to oppose it, as that would simply deprive local government of much-needed resources for the coming year. But we have serious concerns about the overall allocation of resources to local councils across Scotland. As has already been mentioned, I attended the COSLA conference on Friday alongside other spokespeople, including Alex Cole-Hamilton. And I think it's fair to say that SNP and Green ministers were left in no doubt of how council leaders and councillors across the country do feel about this settlement. Councils have yet again been left in a situation where they have to find savings or cut local services. And it is a simple fact that the SNP Green ministers have cut local council budgets next year by £251 million in real terms. Now, this cut to local government finance has been carried out despite Scotland receiving a record £41 billion block grant from the UK government. So this is decisions taken by SNP Green ministers to cut budgets. And we know that councils across Scotland have joined together to condemn these cuts. As COSLA President Alison Everson said, it's beyond frustrating that the importance of local government's role in enabling communities to live well locally across Scotland has not been reflected in the budget announcement. Yes.
Yep. Minister.
Very grateful to Mr Briggs for giving way. He described the settlement as a record settlement, But that is not consistent with the Scottish Fiscal Commission have said. They've indicated that there's a 5.2% reduction to the Scottish budget. Who's right, Mr Briggs or the Scottish Fiscal Commission?
Ms Briggs.
I think the Minister will be acutely aware that councils have very limited options to actually meet this cut. And that's one of the key parts of this debate, I believe, that the Scottish Government have to realise that when they cut budgets, it hits the most vulnerable in our communities and is damaging to the local government workforce as well. For example, the only options which my council here in the capital have now to try to make up this reduction is around a tourism tax, which the SNP said they would never introduce, or the new car park tax, which will hit the lowest earners hardest. Now, many council leaders are concerned that if they don't actually implement these changes, then the Scottish Government will also penalise them in future years as well. Perhaps that is why Edinburgh City Council is today receiving one of the lowest shares of funding by SNP and Green ministers within this budget. So I hope, Deputy Presiding Officer, that SNP and Green ministers here today will genuinely pause and reflect following this budget process. Many of us have said that in previous budgets, but I really do hope that they consider that this isn't great celebration for councils, that this money is coming. This is going to be difficult decisions for them, and they will have to cut vital public services. Now, we again see a situation where ministers put on the table huge cuts to finances, then they rethink that, and then they come back with a slightly lower cut, and then hope that councils and this parliament will celebrate that. That is simply unacceptable. We need to see the resetting of the relationship and a genuine partnership delivered, which brings respect between the Scottish Government and Scottish Parliament to our local authorities as well, and the powers and the funding which they need to deliver vital local services which we all rely on. Now, we on these benches would take a different approach. It is time for the creation of a new fiscal framework for councils, which would see automatic amounts transferred each year from the Scottish Government's budget to help them deliver vital local services. Deputy Presiding Officer, as I said at the start, we will not oppose the order because we do not want to penalise or disrupt the work of our local authorities. However, we need to highlight the fact that this is a poor funding settlement being delivered by the Scottish Government today, which will impact on all of our communities. It's clear that the SNP Green budget will have a negative impact on councils across Scotland. We are already seeing councils setting budgets with increased council tax, an average of 3%, at a time we are facing a cost of living crisis, increases in charging for local services and cuts to services at the same time. The responsibility for that lies firmly at the door of this SNP Green government today. Deputy Presiding Officer, I hope, as I have said, councils will face an opportunity in the future to have a grown-up, responsible debate with ministers around the finance they receive and the finance they need. Councils will face many difficult decisions in the coming weeks and years. So I hope SNP Green ministers will reset that approach and prioritise local government, which is something we all want to see across this parliament. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call on Mark Griffin on behalf of Scottish Labour. Up to 5 minutes, please, Mr Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Labour will vote for the order today. We do so reluctantly, with no enthusiasm, to ensure councils get the allocations offered, and more in hope than expectation that the cost of living support package makes it into the pockets of those who need it most. We disagreed with the SNP Green budget because it will continue to squeeze our local authorities dry. It's not a fair funding package for our communities. It's a timid, uninspiring budget. It forces councils to comply and make more cuts while they struggle to keep up with the demand for local services. The government's delusional spin said that the budget represents a total cash increase, an increase in real terms, but as we should come to expect, year on year, it's in fact packed full of cuts. The overall pie might have increased, but only because the proportion of the ring-fenced budget, the bit locally elected councillors can't make decisions on, has increased 70-fold since 2013. This year alone will jump from 11.5% of their budget to 17.9% of the revenue grant. Councils came into this budget-setting process setting out what they would need to survive, £700 million, and to thrive, they estimated £1.5 billion extra. But that plea must have fallen on deaf ears because it was business as usual for the SNP and the Greens, and what they got was nothing. Funding for core services is flat. the same as it was in 2021-2022, and therefore a real terms cut. And in a matter of months, the difference will be magnified further as runaway inflation takes hold, pay claims come in, and the service demand escalates when people struggle and the cost of living crisis worsens. And that comes on top of a decade of cuts. A decade of cuts that mean, since 2013-14, the core services budget, the income from the general revenue grant and business rates, is worth now £911 million less in real term. The SNP has let inflation eat away at services across the country. Glasgow's budget is worth £182 million less. North Lanarkshire, £69 million. Edinburgh, £65 million. That's millions of pounds gone. Gone from the services that keep our towns, villages and communities going. It's no wonder, then, that social work is on its knees. Roads are crumbling, libraries have closed and bins overflow weekly. That's what years of the SNP raiding council budgets gets us, stripping services to the bone, just as this order will do. And when we look at the period of Scottish Government allocations over the same period, the revenue budget has grown by 8%, but core council funding has been slashed by 12% since 2013-14. And worse, more is still to come. The £120 million the Cabinet Secretary found is not baseline, so 2022 will be spent looking for further savings in 2023. The one-off £30 million Council got in the autumn to settle a play game wasn't baselined either. And there's no headroom for next year. Local government pandemic heroes, patronised all year long by government ministers and told they're not comparable to NHS workers, fear an even worse pay offer this year, which will fall behind the cost of living. Councils know to expect a very difficult industrial landscape ahead, just as the Local Government Committee heard, but as ever, the Government seems unwilling to listen. And finally, Presiding Officer, I want to raise with the Minister the appalling choice to copy the Tory cost of living council tax rebate and simply stick a salt iron on it. Now, despite the SNP promising repeatedly to reform council tax, we're no further forward in abandoning the Tories' regressive local taxation system. Council tax has never been a proxy for income, but to hugely wasteful effect, the Government's own figures show that 40% of those due that £150 have above-average incomes, and around 100,000 of the richest households, those with the top 10% of incomes, are set to receive that £150 because they live in properties Band A to D. But more importantly than that, Presiding Officer, I think payments should be made directly to people so that they can budget for themselves, just as we proposed with our fuel payment. It would be absolutely disastrous if that £150 went towards the £260 million of council tax debt that 300,000 households owe. The Presiding Officer, it's a poor offer, just like the wider package for local government, which won't do much to support those who need the help most or support our communities. Thank you.
Thank you. And I now call on Alex Cole-Hamilton on behalf of the Scottish Liberal Democrats. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much indeed, Deputy Presiding Officer. I rise for the Liberal Democrats, and this is an important debate, as Miles Briggs said. It isn't just a technical debate. And I have to start by saying that the tone of the Minister's remarks was quite frankly astonishing, because it jars terribly with the message that we are all receiving from our councils, our councillors and public servants, the ones that are at the sharp end of this coalition government's choices. I was on the panel discussion, as I said, at COSLA's annual conference last Friday. Miles Briggs was too. And alongside me were Ben McPherson and Lorna Slater. And their defence of this local government settlement was entirely eviscerated. Public servants from across Scotland spoke out about the devastating choices they are being forced to make as a result of these cuts. I don't know whether it was because the SNP and Green Ministers didn't feed anything back from that meeting, or whether they even tried to effect any kind of change. But it is deeply regrettable that there has not been any kind of rethink. Now, as I said at stage three of the budget, this finance secretary has set the same elephant trap as her predecessors. Year after year, the SNP lay down a punishing cut to councils, only to offer a little extra cash at the 11th hour and expect to be lauded as some kind of heroes for so doing. But make no mistake, deleting £370 million from the budget, only to restore £120 million of that, still leads to a £250 million cut. It, as Anas Sarwar said at the COSLA event, it's a bit like taking £20 from your wallet and giving you £5 back and expecting to be thanked for it. Now, it was very clear from the COSLA conference that nobody involved at any level of running public services is fooled by the claims that there's any kind of funding boost here or additional funding. Everyone can see right through those tricks. And there are no heroes today on the government benches, and that includes the Scottish Green Party, who have been busy this week trying to claim that they are having an influence in government and getting things done. Well, what I didn't see among the slim pickings in the press and social media was the Scottish Greens taking the credit for their coalition's £250 million cut to our local authorities. It is the single biggest decision that they have made since entering this government, and it is a rotten one. It stinks. And while Green and SNP MSPs don't want to own it, there is no escaping the harm that it will do to local services in every community and in every corner of Scotland. Presiding Officer, I want to end this contribution with an appeal, because those same communities are already busy working out what they can do to help the people of Ukraine. I've written to the External Affairs Secretary, Angus Robertson, to ask him to ensure that local authorities are provided with the new funding to support those fleeing the invasion. And last week, STV News revealed that as many as 300 Afghans remain in temporary bridging accommodation. 151 are still in hotels here in Edinburgh. That's nowhere near good enough. We are not ready for the influx of refugees. I'm determined that both Scotland and the UK make generous offers of support to those who have to leave their country for fear for their lives. There is not a moment to lose in preparing our offers of safe harbour, in preparing our communities and our councils to receive them, including what that means across services, including housing, education and health. That must be backed up by funding to ensure that everyone who arrives is given every opportunity to start a new life, and for the long term, if needs be. I hope that the Minister will address this in closing and set out details of when those plans will be published and what support the Scottish Government is prepared to give local authorities getting ready to receive those refugees. Thank you.
Thank you. And I now call on the Minister, Tom Arthur, to respond to the debate. Up to 4 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I'm grateful to colleagues from across the Chamber for their contributions in the debate this afternoon. And would like to welcome the comments, in particular from Mr Briggs and Mr Griffin, who respectively stated that they will not oppose and indeed will vote for the order, and I welcome that. Let me pick up on the important point raised by Alex Cole-Hamilton at the end. He will be aware that we have committed £4 million in aid to support Ukraine, and we of course stand ready to do whatever we need to do to support any Ukrainians fleeing the brutal terror of Vladimir Putin's incursion and invasion into Russia. And of course, we will keep the Chamber fully informed of developments as that progresses. And I think he knows our position with regards to we want to see the UK Government go further. We support what the UK Government has done so far, but we believe in the UK Government has to go further. And I'm sure that's a position that Mr Cole-Hamilton would agree with. I recognise that a lot of the arguments we've had this afternoon are rehearsing arguments we have had previously. I do want to pick up on 3 points in a constructive tone. The first was the issue that Mr Briggs raised with regards to a fiscal framework. Now, I recognise the Tory proposition is that should be a predetermined fixed amount of the Scottish budget. I think I welcome the fact there was an idea being put on the table and offered, but I think it's when it requires careful scrutiny. As members will be aware, the Cabinet Secretary is engaging with local government at pace on the development of a fiscal framework. This is a long-standing commitment that, of course, we had to pause pursuing when we were confronted with the immediate and acute crisis of the pandemic, but one that we are taking forward. Of course, this is something that has to be agreed through engagement and partnership with local government, and I'm sure that is something members would understand and appreciate. The second point I wanted to pick up on, and I apologise to Mr Griffin if I misheard him, I think he did mention the issue of ring funding. He will be aware through the resource spending review that the Cabinet Secretary has given a commitment to a full review of ring fencing for local government, recognising that is something the local government have raised in previous years. That will obviously require engagement with local government, but we stand ready to have these conversations. We encourage local government to offer their ideas and the opportunity to move to an approach based upon mutual trust and partnership, where we have shared outcomes. And in pursuing these shared outcomes and objectives, we also ensure best value. On the issue of council tax, the member will obviously realise and respect that the government honoured its manifesto commitments of 2011 and 2016. He will be aware of the commitment that the government has made in partnership with the Scottish Green Party to move towards a deliberative process culminating in a citizens' assembly to look at the resourcing of local government and including on council tax. And that work, I'm pleased to confirm, is underway, certainly.
Miles Briggs.
The Minister taking an intervention on this point. With regards to the £150 cost of living payment, which Scottish ministers have said they want to go out before the end of April, can he confirm to Parliament that the software and information which councils will need to deliver that is now in place?
Minister.
I'm not in a position right now to speak on behalf of local government, but it does pick up a point in relation to what Mr Griffin said. Look, the Cabinet Secretary, when she announced the funding, recognised that this is not perfect. But I think we should not make the perfect an enemy of the good. The reality is it was a priority to get this money out. And of course, we could have taken more time to go and design systems, but I think the clear priority was to get money out, and that's what we're seeking to deliver, certainly.
Mark Griffin.
I think if the Minister could just clarify that not a single penny of that funding should go towards paying existing council tax debt, that would ensure that it reached those who need it most.
Minister.
What I would say is that in recognition that we have sought to ensure that this money is a cash payment, but we have to recognise that this is being delivered by a local government and ultimately local government is administering it. But I do take the point that the member is making. I think the final point, is it 4 minutes, presiding officer? Well, I'll need to conclude at this particular point. There's a lot more that I could say, but I think the thing that's been lacking from the comments, and I have sought to take a constructive tone, but what has been lacking once again, presiding officer, in this discussion around local government finance, is any sense of what budget line should be deprioritised to allow for additional investment in the budget. Now, I want to have a mature debate around local government financing, but it is not enough simply to come to the Chamber and say there should be more money for local government, but not any indication of where that money should come from. So I hope that this can be the last year we have this conversation that we have every year. And as we move into the budget process next year, if members believe that the local government finance settlement should be increased, which is a perfectly legitimate position to take, I hope that they will identify from which budget line that should be taken. But on that note, presiding officer, I will conclude.
Thank you, Minister. And that concludes the debate on Local Government Finance, Scotland Order 2022. And it is now time to move on to the next item of business.